morning to you. And if you will you all stand with me and let's sing Standing on the Promises.
Standing on the promises of Christ, my King.
Standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. morning. Welcome to Fulton Free Will this morning. We are glad you are with us on this beautiful Lord's Day. Let me give you just a few announcements this morning. Don't forget, we're still collecting candy for our trunk or treat that we'll be taking part in on December the 31st downtown. So if you could help out with that, we would still greatly appreciate that. Also, fifth quarter, we're going to be hosting the fifth quarter this Friday night following the ball game. So there's a sign-up sheet out on the table over here. And so if you would like to help out with food for that, then again, we would greatly appreciate that. Also, Operation Christmas Child is kind of underway. And if you need, basically the idea is if you'll just fill a shoebox, and in next week's bulletin, we will have an insert for you that will tell you what you can put in there and what you can't not put in there, because there are some restrictions on that. And so just one of those little 97-cent plastic containers at Walmart, you can fill those up and tape those up, or you can use a regular shoebox if you'd like. But we're doing that until November the 13th. That's the deadline. So just keep that in mind. We've still got a few weeks to do that, and so please keep that in mind. Women interested in growing spiritually, otherwise known as WINGS, will be meeting today at 4:45, and so please keep that in mind. And then also a couple of kids' ministry announcements. Number one is on November the 6th. The kids will be singing in our Sunday morning service, so be praying for the children as they do that on the 6th. And then on November the 5th, that Saturday evening, from 6:30 to 8, here at it'll be down in the Family Life Center. The kids are going to come practice for that Sunday, and then also just have some good kids' games and activities and food and that kind of stuff. So November the 5th from 6:30 to 8. So kids, parents, keep that in mind. And then this coming Wednesday night in our kids' ministry down called Dive, this Wednesday will be popcorn night. So adults will teach fast, and then we'll go eat us some popcorn. No, I'm just kidding. But so just remember that, kids, as well. All right, let's have our ushers come forward, and we will receive our morning tithes and offerings. As they are coming, be in prayer for each other. The change of weather is hitting all of us, I think. It feels like that. And then there's a lot of just various illnesses that are still floating around. And so just be in prayer for one another down through the week. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for this day, and thank you for the opportunity, Father, to be in your house. We look so forward to this day, Lord, where we can come together to honor you, to worship you, to lift up the name of Christ. And so, Father, we pray today that you would just minister to us. We pray that you would touch hearts and lives. Lord, if there's one who needs you for salvation, may this be the day that they surrender to Christ. Lord, if there is a child of God, Lord, who has wandered away, may this be the day they return home. And so, Father, we give this time over to you. We just pray you'll use it for your honor and your glory. We pray your blessings on the offering. We ask all this in Christ's name. Amen.
Sing it again together this morning. Are you washed in the blood?
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you in the blood? blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
For our last hymn this morning, let's sing all four verses when we all get to heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. When traveling days are over, not a shadow but a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Thank you.
All right, Children's Church can be dismissed. If you have your Bibles, you can go ahead and be turning with me to the book of Mark, Mark chapter 10. We'll be coming to this passage in just a few minutes. Mark chapter 10. So I need your help to open the sermon, all right? So I need you to respond. God is good all the time. And God is good. So my question is, a couple of questions would be, number one, is this statement true? And we know the answer is yes. But also, what do we mean when we say good? This morning we are, as we know, we are in the middle of our Fruit of the Spirit series. And we have worked our way up to goodness. The fruit of the Spirit is goodness. And so we want to read our base text, Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. We use the word good in all sorts of situations and circumstances. And I think we use it so much, I think we can forget that we're using the word good because we use it so much. So I want to give you a few examples. In sports, when Emma and Grant play ball, I will tell them that they played good. Now, I may also tell them, well, you could have done this or you could have done that, like a good dad, of course. But I will always come back to, well, you played pretty good. Now, I know what all you're waiting on me to say, so I'm just going to go ahead and get out of the way. Ohio State did not play good last night. And we'll move on. I think we would also all agree that when we look at the current quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys, Dak Prescott, we would say he's playing some pretty good football. So we use good when it comes to sports. We also use it when it comes to food. Now, if I had to choose one thing, people ask you, if there's one item, you're on a deserted island and you get one item to eat, what is that one item? Mine's going to be filet mignon, right? I mean, it's a deserted island. You might as well have something good. So think about that perfect food that you love so much. Mine would be a filet mignon cooked medium. And so when it comes out on that hot plate and you slice into that thing and it's so tender you could use a butter knife and you put that first juicy bite of filet mignon in your mouth and you sit back and all you say is, that is good. It's not just good, right? It's not just good. It's good. We use good for food. And then usually what we say after we've sat there and eat that whole big meal that we don't know we don't need to eat is, I'm so full I can't even breathe, right? You ever been there? You done that? And so my kids make fun of me. I'm just going to be honest. So my kids make fun of me. They know when I'm getting full because I'll go, and all I'm doing is getting a second wind so you can go back into what you're eating. That's all. I'm just making room for more. That's all I'm doing. But we use it for sports, we use it for food, and we also use it for people. When we're talking about someone, we will usually say something to the effect of, they are a good person. He's a pretty good guy. He's a good gal. Or she's a good gal. Sorry. Just being gender neutral. Anyway. But we'll use those types of words. And we'll teach our kids that it is not good to lie, cheat, and steal. And when we use these words good, we're making a judgment statement. But my question is, when it comes to people, and we're making this moral judgment about people, why do we say they're good? What do we mean when we say they're good? Do we say it because they take care of their family and they pay their bills? Do we mean it by because they've not been in jail? Do we say it because they have a college degree? Or do we say it because they go to a certain church? What do we mean by when we say that someone is good? So I want us to this morning, as we think about this and we look at this idea of the fruit of the Spirit is goodness, I want us to answer three questions. And I think after we answer these three questions, I'm hoping we'll have a better understanding of this idea about goodness. So the three questions will be, what is good? The second is, who is good? And then based on the answer of who is good, we answer the third question, which is, how do we then do good? So the first question, what is good? And I think I put the definition up on the screen for you. It's one definition I came across that I thought was helpful. It comes from Easton's Bible Dictionary. And this is what it says. Goodness in man is not a mere passive quality, but the deliberate preference of right to wrong. The firm, persistent resistance of all moral evil, and the choosing and the following of all moral good. Now, so I wrote down my own personal little definition, which is just simply the choosing to believe and do all that is morally right and to resist all that is morally wrong. I heard many years ago the saying, simply put, do the right, shun the wrong. How many ever heard that? Do the right, shun the wrong. But who decides what is morally right and wrong? Do we as a society decide what is morally right or wrong? Do we as individuals decide what is morally right or wrong? You see, if we as people decide what is morally right or wrong, morals will always change. So I want to give you some examples. As we have watched over the years, as babies in their mother's womb have been reduced to nothing more than mere tissue by our society. And then we have politicians who come along and agree with that statement, that babies are just mere tissue so that they can get a certain segment of the population to vote for them. We're watching not only as we have watched over the years that it's okay to kill your baby in the womb. Now we're coming upon a place, and I've mentioned this on Wednesday night, that it's becoming a scary place, that now we're moving beyond the womb to a place where we are saying that it's okay. It's becoming okay to kill someone who may have a terminal disease and may be in substantial pain, and we call that euthanasia. In essence, what we have decided is that we as humans have been elevated to God, and that we get to decide what is right and what is wrong. And because we've decided that something is good, then we must deem it good, because we've elevated ourselves to God. I must remind us that when we decide to play God and determine what is good, what we end up with is what's called the Holocaust. When we decide to play God and we decide what is good, we end up killing more than 58 million babies since Roe v. Wade was passed. That is an entire generation of people. We wonder why we don't have enough money in Social Security. It's because we killed 58 million people who would have already paid into Social Security. Just saying. By the way, that is the modern day Holocaust, when you wipe out 58 million people. So there must be a way of determining what is good beyond mere human intellect and feeling. Now listen, we're living in a culture where it's all about feeling, right? If I feel this, then it must be correct. But as we've just illustrated, if we go simply by human intellect and feeling, where does that take us? I think as we answer the second question, it will give us some light as to where good comes from. So in Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 22, Jesus has been ministering, he's been proclaiming the kingdom of God. The word about Jesus has been spreading throughout the land, and he's going to have a conversation with a rich young man. And this story, if you've been in church, you're familiar with the story, but there's some things in it that I want us to take note of that I think will help us when we think about this idea of good and goodness. Mark chapter 10, verse 17 says, And as he was setting out on his journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments: do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, and do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and your mother." And he said to him, "Teacher, all these things I have kept from my youth." And Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, "You lack one thing. Go, sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come, follow me." Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Now, so what is good? The second question. Or rather, who is good? Who is good? Now, some will say that Jesus, in this statement that he makes, is denying his divinity with saying that only God is good. But that's really not the case at all. I like how one writer put it. He said, quote, "Rather, he is using a penetrating question to push the man to think through the implications of his own words, to understand the concept of Jesus' goodness, and most especially the man's lack of goodness." And we're going to see how that plays out here in just a moment. So a couple of ideas I want us to see as we unwrap this idea of who is good. The first and foremost thing is simply this: God alone is good. Psalm 34, verse 8 says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him." Notice that it's not just that God does good, but that he is good. It's both. The reason he does good is because he is good. And the reason he is good is because he is holy and he is perfect. He is holy and he is perfect. There is no sin in God. He is absolutely pure. Therefore, he is good. Therefore, everything he does is good. When we look at creation in Genesis chapter 1, at the very end of the chapter, after he's created everything in 6 days, we see in verse 31, and it says, "And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good." Because everything that God does is good. So God is good. So let's look at the reality of humanity. Humanity is not good. Now, this flies in the face of modern-day teaching. Modern-day teaching says, "Oh, we're good people. We're good people." If you were to go into the street today and just walk up to somebody at Walmart or the restaurants you eat at lunch, and you just walk up and say, "I just got a question for you. Do you think you're a good person?" More than likely, 99% of the people you ask will say, "Yeah, I'm a pretty good person. I think I'm a good person." And the reason they'll say that they're a good person is because they are looking at other people to determine whether they themselves would qualify in their own eyes as a good person. When we compare ourselves to other people, we can find some really, what we would call really rotten, nasty people. And we will look at those people and say, "Wow, compared to those people, I'm a good person." But that's the downfall. The downfall is to compare yourself to others. Because in reality, we must look to God. And when we compare ourselves to God, who is holy and perfect and pure, we realize that we are not good. If you just simply, as many people have done over the last several years, taken the Ten Commandments and used it as a way of putting a mirror up, as Paul talks about, and you use the law to show people just how bad we really are. If you just take a few of the commandments, you'll understand that you really are a liar, a murderer at heart, an adulterer at heart. And you'll walk away going, wow, in reality, if I'm honest with myself, I'm not a good person. I want to remind you of what Jesus did here. Again, let's look at verse 19. Jesus says, he says, why do you call me good? No one's good except God. In verse 18, then he says, you know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and your mother. And he said, teacher, all these things I've kept from my youth. And so Jesus is looking at the man, loved him, and said to him, you lack one thing. Go and sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possession. The man had an eagerness to follow the commandments, but he had left off the most important commandment in his life. And that is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. He was looking at all these horizontal commandments, and he had left off in his own life the vertical, which is to love God with all that we have. The man's issue was that he loved his possessions more than he loved God. And listen, Jesus knew this man's heart. That's why he said to him what he said. Jesus was not saying that the only way you can become a believer is to sell everything you have. He was getting to the man's heart. Now, it's different for all of us in the sense that God calls us to all sorts of different things in life. And does he sometimes call people after salvation to maybe sell all their stuff? Yeah. He's God. He can do that. But that's not the point here. Jesus was not teaching that in order to be right with God, you must sell everything. Rather, he was simply showing the man that he was not as, quote-unquote, good as he thought he was. Because, now just think about it for a moment. If Jesus is looking at you and said, and you've asked him the question, how do I inherit eternal life? And he goes, well, you know the commandments. Do not murder, do not steal, do not commit adultery, do all these things. And that young man goes, oh. I've done those since I was a youth. He's probably feeling pretty good about himself. And then Jesus lays the hammer down and says, let me hit you in one more spot where I know it's going to hit the hardest. Go sell everything. Follow me. And you'll have treasure in heaven. I remind us of Romans chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. It says, as it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside, together they have become worthless. Now listen to it, no one does good, not even one. So the truth is that we as humans are not good. We are sinners who needs the forgiveness of the Savior. And we are all in the same boat. You've heard me make that statement. So I decided today to expand on my little statement that we're all in the same boat to hopefully help us to see this. The boat that we're in has massive holes in it. And it's sinking fast. And every time we sin, another hole pops in the boat. And the ship is going down. And the reason we can't get off the boat is because we are shackled to the boat. And we are not going to get ourselves off the boat. And it is sinking. But if we will call on the name of Christ, not only does He come and unshackle us from the boat. He literally lifts us up and takes us to safety. Now, why do I say that? Because listen to me. If he only unshackled us and left us on the boat, can I tell you, if we're just honest with ourselves, because of the way sin works, we would be like the people who were on the Titanic. While the Titanic was sinking, there were some people who stood there and listened to the music playing. We would stay on the boat. So Jesus has to come along, unshackle us, and lift us up and place us on safe ground. That is salvation. Because we're not capable of getting ourselves off the sinking ship. And every human being is sinking in sin. If you're here without Christ, you are sinking today. Whether you realize it or not, whether you want to acknowledge it or not, that's the reality. So then, how do we do good? Well, if we go back to the account of Jesus and the rich young ruler, I think we find the answer. One writer put it this way: the fundamental lesson here is that goodness flows not from man's deeds, but rather from God Himself. Why? Because only God is truly good. So let me remind us, I want to give us some myths about not only from unbelievers, but even as believers. We have some things we need to overcome. When we think about doing good, about being good as believers, there's some things we need to overcome and get some stinking thinking out of our life. So for unbelievers, sometimes they may believe that Christianity is all about doing good, and that by doing good, that makes you right with God. But that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches, for by grace you have been saved through faith, that not of works. So we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus, apart from works. It has nothing to do with works. It has nothing to do with how good of a person you think you are. Some say, I don't need church to be a good person. I would agree with that. It's because you need Jesus. We all need Jesus. Others, they judge themselves by the standards of the world, and therefore they think, again, that they are okay with God. But when you compare yourself to who God is, it just doesn't pan out. As Christians, we have some issues as well. Some believe that they will never be good enough to please God. And you're right. You're right. That is why we trust Jesus and His finished work on the cross of Calvary. Because we will never be good enough. That's why we trust Jesus. Not only that, some believe that they are not good enough to inherit the kingdom of God. Even after salvation, they just feel so unworthy. And I'm telling you, if that's the way you feel, you're not trusting in the finished work of Jesus. I know we're sinners, but He saves sinners. And He makes us right for the kingdom. And so we have to trust in Him and what He's done for us. We cannot have this in our mindset that even after salvation, that, well, if I'll just do these things, then God's going to be more pleased with me. It's stinking thinking. And I've touched on this one before, but it bears repeating, that we get this concept in our minds for some reason that even after salvation, we have to do all these good things in order for God to love us and for Him to keep loving us. And the reality is God loves you as much today as He's ever going to love you. He loves you to the max. There's no decrease in His love. So let's come back to Galatians chapter 5. Because we have to always end up back at Galatians because that's our base text. So the fruit of the Spirit is goodness. We have to get this. We have to understand this. We must understand, again, listen to that. I'm going to give you that quote from earlier, that goodness flows not from man's deeds, but from God Himself. The fruit of the Spirit is goodness. That means the Holy Spirit will produce in us goodness. He will cause and strengthen us to be good and to do good. We must surrender completely to Christ. We must love Him with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. When we surrender to Him totally, when we love Him completely and fully, the Spirit of God who is at work in us will produce goodness. He is the one that will help us to do the right and shun the wrong. Our problem is we try to do everything in our own power and in our own strength in this thing called Christianity. And we have to get off of that. And we must rely more on the Spirit of God who lives in us, who is the one who is doing the work in us, who is molding us and making us into His image so that we can do good. I put it this way. When we surrender and love Him with everything, we will be amazed, listen, at His goodness in our lives. His goodness in our lives. Notice we have nothing to do with that but surrender. We have nothing to do with that except love Him. And as we love and surrender, He's just going to do all these things in and through us. It is when we surrender to Him that we can stand in a political season and we can just stand and say, you know what? No matter what goes on, I'm going to stand for biblical principle. No matter what the world says. It's willing to stand in the face of kids at school and say, you may be going in that direction, but my Lord's telling me I need to go in this direction. So I'm going to go this way, and you can go your way, and I'm just going to do what Jesus says I need to do. As adults at the workplace, when those horrible things are being talked about at the water fountain, they say, having the courage to listen to the Spirit who lives inside you, producing that goodness in you, to give you the courage to just walk away. And not participate. Because your relationship with Jesus is more important than those people. When we surrender, He will produce in us that thing called goodness. So have you surrendered? Have you surrendered for salvation? But listen, have you surrendered as a believer to the Lordship of Jesus? Because part of loving Him with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength is surrendering to His Lordship. And as Christians, we must surrender to Him as Savior and Lord. So have you surrendered? Let me get you to stand. This is that moment in the service where everybody knows what's coming. And what I want you to do for just a moment is I want you to forget about where you're headed in about 10 minutes. And I want you to forget about the ball game that's coming on at 12 or 12:30 or what you're going to be doing this evening. And I want you to focus on Jesus for just a moment. And I want you to ask yourself, have I completely and totally surrendered to Him? Let me get you to bow your heads just for a moment. If you're here this morning and you, first of all, you say, I know that I need salvation. I have not surrendered to Christ for salvation. That I am indeed, I realize, I am that sinking ship today. And I realize that without Christ, truly I will die in my sin. And can I tell you that if you die in your sin, you will not see the glory and beauty of heaven. If you're here today and you realize you need Jesus for salvation, can I get you to slip your hand up and put it right back down? No one's looking around. I appreciate that. Just in your own honesty, if you ask yourself, have I surrendered to Jesus for salvation? And your answer is no. Can I get you to just slip your hand up and say, please pray for me. Thank you for your honesty. Thank you for your honesty. Can I tell you, if you're here today, you don't have to leave in the same condition in which you came. You can leave here knowing that you are forgiven because you've repented of your sin and you've placed your faith in Jesus Christ. I'm going to pray here in just a moment, and if for that, for those that lifted hands that say they needed salvation, as I pray today, I'm going to invite you to come and surrender to Jesus and let Him rescue you from that sinking ship. Christian, are you under His lordship? Have you totally surrendered? If there's something in your own life, believer, that you know that Jesus has pinpointed, that the Holy Spirit of God has pricked at your heart and in your mind, and He showed you that one thing, and He's dealing with you about that one thing, I'd like to pray for you. Can I get you to slip your hand up and put it right back down? Say, the Lord's showing me that one thing that I need to surrender to Him. I'm going to pray, and if you're here today and you need that salvation and you're ready to surrender, then as I pray, I want you to come. And someone will meet with you and will show you and will pray with you and talk with you, and you can leave here knowing that your sins are forgiven, and that you're a child of God, and that you've been rescued from that sinking ship. Father, we thank you today. And Father, I pray for that one that needs to come, Lord, that you would give them the courage and the strength to even now step out and come. Father, I pray that you would minister to them, that you would strengthen them. Father, I pray that before this day is over, that they will have surrendered to Jesus Christ. Lord, all of us, if we were to ask ourselves, and if someone was to ask us, Lord, do we want to be good? Do we want to do good? Lord, I would dare say the majority of us, almost all of us, would say, yes, we want to be that. We want to do that. But Lord, help us to realize that without you, we cannot be good or do good. But Lord, with you, with the Spirit of God who lives in us, you will produce goodness in us. And Father, I thank you for that promise. I thank you, Lord, that you are at work in our lives at producing this fruit, the fruit of the Spirit. Help us, Lord, to love you. Help us to serve you. Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for everyone that's made a choice to be in your house today. And Lord, again, I just pray for that one that they would surrender before the day is over. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Excuse me. Thank you so much for being with us today. We'd love for you to come back and be with us this evening at 6 o'clock. We'd love for you to be with us. And don't forget on Wednesday that the kids will be having their popcorn night. Don't forget November the 5th and the 6th with our kids. The activities they're going to do on the 5th and then the singing on the 6th. And don't forget fifth quarter. We have so many things going on right now. I'm just trying to remind you. So don't forget we've got fifth quarter this coming Friday. And you can sign up on the sheet out there for that. And we would really appreciate that. All right. I'm going to ask Brother Steve Wood if he would dismiss us in prayer.